What happened in Germany in 9 AD to the general Varus that Suetonius says was almost fatal and prompted Augustus to order that watch be kept by night throughout the city to prevent any outbreak? What happened that caused Augustus to dash his head against a door crying, "Quintilius Varus, give me back my legions"? Varus first appears in Book 54 of Cassius Dio to say that he was consul in 13 BC. He next pops up in the historian Josephus during the reign of Herod the Great. Josephus writes that Varus was president of Syria and was come as an assessor to Herod, who had desired his advice in his present affairs. Now, it is to be remembered that Rome ruled the world in part by supporting vassal kings like Herod, and Varus would find himself playing arbiter over a dispute between Herod and his son Antipater, who had apparently tried to kill him. And according to Josephus, it was generally assumed that when Antipater was killed afterwards, it had been done by Herod with Varus's approval. After this, Varus returns to Syria, but he returns back onto the record of Josephus after Herod dies, because in the wake of the king's death, a whole bunch of Jewish factions vie for control of Judea. Some of these Jews even lay siege to the city of Jerusalem and the Roman legion that is stationed there. Varus marches across Judea, he burns down Emmaus, advances on Jerusalem, finds the Jewish siege abandoned, but he nevertheless tracks down those besiegers and crucifies 2,000 of them. With the benefit of historical hindsight, we might amuse ourselves a little bit with the thought that this man who so oppressed the Jews would meet his end quite bitterly at the hands of a bunch of Germans. But along those lines, it is interesting when we see these words from Josephus that there was a contingent of Germans marching in the funeral procession for Herod. So they were both Gauls and Germans in Jerusalem around the time of the birth of Christ. I didn't know that, that's for sure. So who were these Germans? A huge invasion of Germans took place and is described in Plutarch's Life of Caius Marius. That goes back to even before the time of Sulla. Next, we meet the Germans again, significantly in Julius Caesar, who described them as particularly barbaric, worse so than the Gauls. He won a major military victory over a German leader by the name of Ariovistus, who had invaded across the Rhine into Gaul. Back in Book 53, Cassius Dio had told us, some of the Celts, whom we call Germans, had occupied all the Belgic territory which borders the Rhine and named it Germany. The southern portion of this region extends to the sources of the Rhine and the northern to the British Ocean. And Tacitus in his Germania confirms for us, the name of Germany is new and a recent application. Roman interaction with the Germans has been popping up until now in Cassius Dio, but it hasn't been so important that it requires mentioning. But we should talk a little bit about Tacitus, because he tells us more about who these people were. They're ancient hymns, says Tacitus, their only style of record or history which they possess, celebrate a god Tuisto, a scion of the soil. To him they ascribe a son, Manus, the beginning of their race, and to Manus, three sons, its founders. This is the origin of our word for man. We as English speakers should show an interest in barbarian German history. This is our cultural past, whether or not were actually Germans. Tacitus can also amuse, right? Here's what Tacitus writes about the landscape. Who would have left Asia or Africa or Italy to look for Germany? With its wild scenery and harsh climate, it is pleasant neither to live in nor to look upon, unless it be one's fatherland. He also tells us about this battle cry. Baritus is the name they use. Probably the origin of the word baritone, they tried to make this sound as low a register as they could. He also describes them as having fierce blue eyes, red hair, tall frames, powerful only spasmodically, not correspondingly tolerant of labor and hard work, and by no means habituated to bearing thirst and heat, to cold and hunger, thanks to the climate and the soil they are accustomed. They carry short spears, they take their kings on the ground of birth, their generals on the basis of courage. They further record how Hercules appeared among the Germans, and on the eve of battle, the natives hymn Hercules, the first of brave men. And he also says a section of the Suebi sacrifices also to Isis. I think that's interesting. It goes to what we were saying in Josephus. The world was not so compartmentalized as we might think. Egyptian culture had spread to Germany. Traitors and deserters are hung from trees. Cowards and poor fighters and sexual perverts are plunged in the mud of marshes with a hurdle on their heads. The difference of punishment has regard to the principle that crime should be blazoned abroad by its retribution, but abomination hidden. So in Book 56, Chapter 18 of Cassius Dio, we learn that the Romans had a hold on parts of it, that is Germany, not whole regions, but merely those areas which happened to have been subdued. Bodies of troops were in the habit of wintering there, and cities were being founded. The barbarians were gradually reshaping their habits in conformity with the Roman pattern, were becoming accustomed to hold markets, and were meeting in peaceful assemblies. But when Quintilius Varus became governor of the province of Germany and in the exercise of his powers, also came to handle the affairs of these peoples, he tried to hasten and to widen the process of change. He not only gave orders to the Germans as if they were actual slaves of the Romans, but also levied money from them. They received Varus, and by pretending that they would comply with all his orders, they lured him far away from the Rhine into the territory of the Cherusci and towards the river Visurgis. This is the river Weser. Among those who were most deeply involved in the plot and took the lead in its planning and in the subsequent fighting were Arminius and Sejmerus. Arminius remains a German hero, and the battle that unfolded is known to history as the Battle of the Teutoburg Forest. Cassius Dio is our historian. An uprising broke out. Peoples who lived at some distance. This had been deliberately contrived to entice Varus to march against them, so that he could the more easily be overwhelmed while he was crossing what he imagined to be friendly territory. And so, the plan unfolded. The Romans, even before the enemy fell upon them, were hard-pressed by the necessity of clearing the tracks and bridging difficult stretches. They had with them wagons and pack animals, which caused them to advance in scattered groups. While the Romans were struggling against the elements, the barbarians suddenly surrounded them on all sides at once, stealing through the densest thickets as they were familiar with the paths. The Germans closed in to shorter range. The Roman troops were not advancing in any regular formation, but were interspersed at random. This meant that they could not easily concentrate their strength at any point. They were everywhere overwhelmed by their opponents. This was actually a 4-day battle, and it was on the second day that they suffered the heaviest casualties. As Cassius Dio tells us, the next day they marched on in somewhat better order, and even broke out into open country. Moving on from there, they re-entered the woods, where they fought back against their assailants, but suffered their heaviest losses in this action. The fourth day saw them still on the move, and again they experienced heavy rain and violent winds, which prevented them from advancing. They could neither draw their bows, nor hurl their javelins to any effect, nor even make use of their shields, which were completely sodden with rain. Varus and all the senior officers, fearing that they would either be taken alive or slaughtered, nerved themselves for the dreaded but unavoidable act and took their own lives. When this news spread to their men, none of the rest, even if strength remained, resisted. Some followed the example of their general. Others threw down their arms and allowed any who chose to slaughter them. This was the nature of the fighting at the Battle of the Teutoburg Forest. And it actually greatly exposed the Roman Empire. There is a reason why Suetonius says that this defeat was nearly fatal. But lucky for the Romans, the Germans had no ability, technologically speaking, to conduct any kind of siege, and they didn't press their advantage. But Rome was vulnerable. It could have been sacked. Tacitus, in chapter 2 of his Annals, tells us 6 years later, Germanicus returned to the site of the battle. They were near the Teutoburgian Wood, in which the remains of Varus and his three divisions were said to be lying unburied. The scene lived up to its horrible associations. Varus's extensive first camp, with its broad extent and headquarters marked out, testified to the whole army's labors. Then a half-ruined breastwork and shallow ditch showed where the last pathetic remnant had gathered. Human heads fastened to tree trunks. In groves nearby were the outlandish altars at which the Germans had massacred the Roman colonels and senior company commanders. The Romans were ritualistically slaughtered by these German nature-worshipping pagans.